Welcome to this time of Sunday meditations on this fourth and final week of this year's Advent journey toward the wonder of Christmas Day. We move increasingly from the time of preparing into the final days of waiting. Waiting with growing anticipation to celebrate anew the mystery and the wonder that is Christmas. God come to be one of us. It is great to have you share this journey with us. May this time help us to live more deeply into God's larger, more loving story of God with us. Moment, as the great season of Advent draws nears its end, and we prepare to welcome this child into the bleakest corners of our ordinary lives, salvation is nearer than it has ever been. That light comes into the world and is never extinguished. And so today we light one more candle to join our hope, our peace and joy, to open ourselves to love again. We continue the story of generations, telling a story into the circle of lights. This fourth light is for compassion and heart. This is the candle of love. Let us honour the light. With this one light, we pray, O God, we place this light in this holy space as a reminder that we are on this journey together. Be light along all our paths. Lead us to a more just world and help us to stay awake and present to your love in each ordinary day. Amen. Let me share with you a story that dates back into the 8th century BC in the prophecy of Isaiah, a time when King Ahaz was caught between two warring kings. And God sends his prophet Isaiah. We read in chapter 7 and verse 10. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear then, O house of Jacob, is it too little for you to weary mortals that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child, and shall bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey by the time he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land before whose two kings you are in dread will be deserted. Friends, in a few days' time, we will be celebrating the birth of Christ. So let us restore our souls and refresh our spirits. And in the words of the psalmist, we say, restore us, O God, let your face shine that we may be saved. Though we are complicit in the frenzy of consumerism, the unreality of expectations, the tension of gift-giving, and the pressure to attend gatherings. Restore, O God, your face, and let your face shine that we may be saved. Though we would like to be more Christ-centered in our daily lives, we know we can turn to God and be restored. So we ask, restore us, O God, let your face shine that we may be saved. Amen. We know we're getting closer to Christmas. We turn in our gospel reading this week to the first chapter of Matthew's gospel. Reading from verse 18. Now, the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she was born, had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. Teach us wisdom, O God. Let your word bring us light. What a wonderful story it is that we're being invited to live into more and more deeply. What a transformative impact that larger, more loving story that we are invited into makes to how we live in the midst of life's conflicts, stresses, and worries. The first thing the Isaiah reading teaches us in such times is to refocus. When King Ahaz found himself in a pincer scenario between two warring kings, he was consumed by fear at what he saw in the others. Now, through Isaiah, he was counseled to worry less about the two kings and more on the behavior in his own kingdom. Aren't we like Ahaz when we find ourselves in times of conflict and change? Don't we focus in on the other, the threat they pose to us, be that emotionally, be that to our reputations, to our well-being, perhaps, or to the things that we treasure and identify with? This story reminds us that one of the critical components of transforming conflict is to not only understand the other, but also to reflect on how we have engaged, how we have possibly contributed to the escalation of the conflict. A second thing we learn from this story is the role of people becoming aware of our troubles, knowing someone else knows. I saw this firsthand while spending time with our friends in Timor-Leste. They had been suffering in silence until a couple of foreigners happened to be filming a peaceful march from the centre of Dili up into the Santa Cruz Cemetery, where the Indonesian soldiers surrounded them and opened fire on that crowd, devastatingly. Those two insiders thought quickly enough to take the film out of their camera, hide it somewhere in that cemetery. And later they went back, retrieved the film and smuggled it out of the country. They took risks to share the story of the Timorese. And suddenly the world was aware of what the Timorese people had been enduring and began to pay attention. It still took some time, but it changed the course of their history when someone else knew and paid attention. It was in that kind of way that God sent along Isaiah, letting it be known God was paying attention. He offered a similar hope, providing the long view for Ahaz, the awareness of God being with humanity in the prophecy of the child who would be born of a young girl who would name her son Emmanuel. God was in effect providing a larger, more loving story for Ahaz to emerge into. And just the promise of that gave peace. Joseph found himself in a similarly pincered scenario that was causing him great internal conflict that followed him into his sleep. It's difficult for us to, in our contemporary world, to fully appreciate, I suspect, the societal pressures and expectations Joseph faced that clashed with his love and his care for Mary. As he grappled with what Mary had shared with him about how her baby was conceived, the angel of God used Isaiah's prophecy to reassure Joseph and allowed him to find peace in that inner conflict and to change his course of action, to find peace between he and Mary, and I suspect between he and God, by connecting him to the larger story a story of love. Sue and I had friends in Tasmania who understood this better than we could. Craig met Bronwyn when she had twin babies. The love he discovered for Bronwyn overcame any societal pressures to not get involved with a woman with twin babies. It was a deep love that saw Craig adopt those two babies as his own. An enduring bond of love that continues long since Bronwyn's early death, when those two erstwhile babies were still teenagers. He was linked to a larger story, a story of love. This is what I hear resounding through today's readings. God's reconciling presence in the eternal Christ, offering us a place in a larger, more loving story. Don't we, when we find ourselves in times of conflict and division, get caught up in our own stories that give rise to fear and confusion and anger and disappointment and frustration and loneliness and so much more? Bringing God's larger, more loving story into these stories and emotions allows us to better understand both our own stories and those of others, cutting across the pain and divisions and suspicions that may have occurred, and helping us to look up and outward and beyond our own individual stories to something much bigger and much better. We often talk about the good news. I think this is better than good news. It is brilliant news. But it's also challenging news. Because if we truly believe in the transformative presence of God in our own lives, then we cannot only tend to our own individual stories. I guess the question then is, how do we move from our individual stories into that larger, more loving one? And our readings offer us some clues. Firstly, it suggests we need to be alert to the signs of hope. Now, I know how easy it is to be cynical in our contemporary experience of the world. With the violence and fear, the pettiness, the self-centeredness that abounds. But if we are paying attention, there are many signs of hope in our world that can not only sustain us, but encourage us that in our own small ways, we all have the ability to make things better. Secondly, these readings suggest that we need to be courageous. Our own stories are familiar. They're comfortable. They help us define ourselves. Looking to the stories of others may challenge and change our own stories. That might make us uncomfortable, perhaps even fearful, perhaps even angry. But we can draw courage from the stories of people of faith like those in today's readings, from others down through history, or perhaps from others we know today. Now, those in today's reading certainly struggled in hearing and understanding different stories. But that larger, more loving story they emerged with was worth the risk. And thirdly, the reading suggests that to even entertain that there is a larger, more loving story for ourselves for those that we are in conflict with, and for our broken world, well, I increasingly believe we need to be rooted in God's love. When we react out of fear, we generally either flee from the conflict or we escalate it. When we act out of love for ourselves and for others, even when we are afraid, we hold space and possibility for transformation. Ultimately, this larger, more loving story of God with us, can bring peace and reconciliation wherever we are in our stories, even in the midst of whatever inner conflict we might be experiencing. In today's world, I would argue that we need to experience the presence of Christ more than ever. Surrounded as we are by economic crisis, an environmental emergency, war, a nuclear threat re-emerging, the pandemic, and continuing changes in our social ordering, even in the church. But even as we await the Christ child this Christmas, we already know the presence of Jesus, God with us, Emmanuel. In God's presence, may despair turn to hope. May violence turn to healing. May fear turn to love. May we let the Prince of Peace meet us where we are and bring us his peace that passes all understanding and enable us to live a larger, more loving story. Enable us all to live a larger, more loving story towards a radical, transformed, God-coloured world. Amen. I share with you another story of the work of Act for Peace that we are invited to be partners in through our giving to the Christmas Bowl. The focus this week is on work to support the many Sri Lankan refugees who are still living in exile in India. Many are ready to make the journey home to the country they love. But the current economic crisis and food shortages in Sri Lanka means it's not safe for them to return, leaving many still needing support in refugee camps. Act for Peace's local partner is the Organisation for Elam Refugees Rehabilitation, OFRA, who are supported by the Australian government through the Australian NGO Cooperation Program. Through the Christmas Bowl, we are able to be part of this program, helping OFRA continue to provide life-saving medical care for refugees while they wait for Sri Lanka to be safe again, when these families will finally be able to find a safe place to belong in their homeland. Here's that story.
Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, wherever you are. I'm Florina Xavier. I work with Act for Peace as the Return and Reintegration Advisor. I'm based in Sri Lanka, but also work with India with the refugees. OFRA in India works with refugees from 107 camps, and we take care of the health aspects of the refugees, making sure that they have first aid medicines, they have regular medical camps, health camps, where they can be part of and then get diagnosed. We also help people with disabilities, giving them equipments that they need so they can sustain themselves. A lot of help is given for livelihood, especially given that there is a lot of food crisis everywhere in the world, and also with the refugees, we find that people need that extra help. So I want to thank you all for helping OFRA in India to provide the medical support that they need well-end camps, but also the health support, the knowledge and skills that they need as they prepare to go home to Sri Lanka and start their lives again. Thank you very much.
May I invite you then into an attitude of prayer as we bring our thoughts and concerns to God and ask God to come among us and make us whole. Let us pray. Into our troubles and weaknesses, into the barren places of our souls, come, Lord. Come down, come in, come among us, and make us whole. Into the war-torn and the refugee, into those who live in conflict, come, Lord. Come down, come in, come among us, and make us whole. Into the homeless and the unemployed, into those who feel abandoned, come, Lord. Come down, come in, come among us, and make us whole. Into the sick and the disabled, into those with Ebola and with cancer and with COVID, come, Lord. Come down, come in, come among us and make us whole. Into the poor and the starving, into those who are oppressed or abused, come, Lord. Come down, come in, come among us and make us whole. Into the lives of loved ones, into those from whom we are estranged, come, Lord. Come down, come in, come among us and make us whole. Into our joys and celebrations, into our work and our achievements, come, Lord. Come down, come in, come among us and make us whole. O Lord, we long for your coming. Hasten that day when those who seek you in every nation will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and sit at table in your kingdom. Hasten the day when your kingdom will come in all its glory, and suffering and pain and sickness and oppression and death will be overcome forever. Hasten the day when we will be resurrected as a great multicultural family and live in peace, harmony, joy, and love together in your kingdom. Hear our prayers, Advent Christ, offered in the name of Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Just before we wrap up this week, I want to share with you these thoughts that were offered by a colleague of mine, Craig Mitchell. I offer them to you as we enter this Christmas week. Loving God, some of us are like Zechariah, not believing that you would choose to bless us. Some of us are like Mary, surprised and humbled by the gift of new life. Some of us are like Joseph, needing reassurance and faith for the way ahead. Some of us are like Elizabeth, supporting others as they begin the journey. Some of us are like the shepherds, unsure whether your presence is real or a dream. Some are like the angels, eager to tell stories of your good news Some are like the innkeeper, not yet realizing how special you really are. Some are like the wise men, kneeling in wonder and worship. Wherever we are in our journey of faith, remind us that your plans lie before us. Help us to grow tall in your love and light, so that we may stand strong and gentle for you in our world. Amen. Perhaps we might recognize ourselves somewhere in that spectrum of people. So as we come to the end of this time of Sunday meditations, an angel came to Joseph and proclaimed, "Emmanuel, God with us." In this final week before Christmas Day, may our waiting proclaim, "Emmanuel, God with us." Go forth in joy to tell the world, "Emmanuel, God with us." May God bless you with a restless discomfort about easy answers, half-truths and superficial relationships, so that you may seek truth boldly and love deeply within your heart. May God bless you with holy anger at injustice, oppression and exploitation of people, so that you may tirelessly work for justice, freedom and peace among all people. May God bless you with the gift of tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, or the loss of all that they cherish, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and transform their pain into joy. May God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you really can make a difference in this world.
Spring comes. blessed by your advent. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, all thank you.